I always love seeing companies innovate and think outside the box, and AtomStack has delivered with this A12 Pro. All right, so I want to run down some of the key features of the A12 Pro and talk about some of the design aspects of this, which make it very unique. Typically with machines kind of in this niche, I would say, they're usually made out of extruded aluminum. They have plastic wheels that roll across that extrusion, and that's kind of how your motion is set up with timing belts and different things like that. This one still uses timing belts, but the frame on this one is a unibody construction. The frame is actually a one-piece cast metal part, and all the good bits and bobs are actually inside the frame. So it's very unique in that respect. The way that it's designed, the unibody construction, also lends itself to some fantastic cable management. That's probably sounds boring to most people. I'm excited about it because in a lot of machines, especially in the extruded aluminum machines, cable management is usually a miss. It's just an absolute disaster. But in this one, it's the cleanest I've ever seen. So that speaks volumes. That does come at a cost with this particular design because the work area is slightly smaller. This work area is 14.37 inches by 12 inches, or 365 millimeters by 305 millimeters, and that's a little bit smaller than most, but the execution of the holistic design is on par with no one that I've seen yet. So that's great. This is a 12 watt machine as described with the A12 Pro. They do have a 6 watt machine and a 24 watt machine as well that's in the same family, I would say. The dot size on this is very small at 0.06 millimeters by 0.06 millimeters. This has an air assist with the F30 air pump. We'll talk more about that later. And then as well as the cable that runs through the cable chain that this has, it also routes the silicon hose for the air, making it even that much cleaner of an execution. The speed on this is very, very good. It's 600 millimeters a second advertised max speed. This has flame detection. It has tilt detection. The focus is very easy. We have two thumb screws on the side. You just lower it down and you use this focusing gauge that is nice anodized aluminum. It has a step for engraving and a step for cutting. So depending on what you want to do, you'll drop the lens cover down onto the right ledge to get the result that you're looking for. This has a lot of accessories. We have one right here, and that is a honeycomb type bed for aid when you're cutting. We have the already mentioned air pump. We have two different styles of rotaries, and I believe there's some other accessories like enclosures that you can buy for this. So there's a pretty good family of components to go with this. This unit works with Laser Gerbil, which is a free software. It also works with the AtomStack's own software, as well as Lightburn. For all my testing, I use Lightburn, and you'll see the good results that I got with that. This machine by itself is $450, so it puts it in a very different bracket from machines that we've most recently looked at. So if you're looking at trying to kind of tiptoe into laser engraving, this would be something that's more attainable, more affordable. In the 24 watt version, just to give you perspective, that base price for that machine is $609. If you wanted to get this machine, the A12 Pro, with the bed, with the air pump, and with the two different rotaries, you're looking at $778 for all of that. Not everybody's going to need a rotary. Not everybody's going to need two rotaries, so the price will come down because of not needing all the accessories. All right, so let's quickly go through what I was able to make with the A12 Pro from AtomStack. The first thing I had to do was kind of relearn the speed and power settings because I switched my software from millimeters per minute to millimeters per second. Doesn't sound like that big of a deal, but I was used to thinking in millimeters per minute. So after 7 tests, I was able to successfully get the Neo 7 CNC squareness test to execute correctly. And the circle does rotate inside the square. It does get snug but for the most part, it rotates all the way around if you really, really try hard. So there's a little something going on. It could be the material too, because this isn't the best material, but all in all, it turned out great. From there, I moved on to this tiger head, and I'm just using these coaster blanks from Amazon, and I'll have links to down to all these materials that I use down below. That's usually where I get everything from. That tiger head turned out good. You're fighting the wood grain on this particular print, and I probably could have gone even darker, but it did turn out fairly well. Interesting story, David. Why do you have the phonetic alphabet on some of those cards? I recently got back from an international trip for work, and as luck would have it, our crew ran into some traveling difficulties when our flight was canceled, or our connecting flight was canceled, that left us stranded in London for a day. And so listening to people trying to redo their airline arrangements and trying to talk about confirmation numbers and alphanumeric, and it gets funny because people are using words that are so not on the phonetic alphabet to describe a letter. And I just thought it was funny. So I found this chart online and I applied it to several of these wooden things, and I will be distributing these at work so that myself and my coworkers can speak with some intelligence when we're trying to use the phonetic alphabet. So a little bit of a segue, but it was funny at the time. From there, I did a little puzzle, and I think I used an online puzzle creator for this. And this is just a 3-inch by 3-inch, but I could see making little puzzles for kids and whatnot. I will say that there should be some marking on the top so that you know which side of the puzzle piece is up, because that's super challenging. Ask me how I know, since I've only done the border. I haven't gotten much of any of the internal pieces actually put in, but the machine did a fantastic job on it. Let's see, from there, I believe I moved over to the craft paper tags, and these are very heavy gauge, like tags as you would use for price tags or gift tags or something like that. But I did this stencil font, and the webs that the machine leaves, because of the small dot size, it's really precise, and it turned out fantastic. That was like a one and done. That turned out beautifully. To kind of test engraving on the tag, I've got this on here. I can actually feel those letters, so I was biting into it pretty hard. I probably could have backed it off a little bit, but it turned out great. From there, I moved on to some slate, and this is a sugar skull that we've seen before on this round slate coaster, and it's slightly off. That was my bad. This machine does have a laser crosshair for lining up your job. If you end up getting this machine, the offset is 15 millimeters as far as the distance from the laser crosshair to the actual laser that's doing the work itself. So inside of Lightburn, you'll have to go in and make that adjustment so that when the job starts, it will actually move to where the crosshair was. I hope I'm explaining that right. But this turned out beautifully, and I accidentally did it in two passes, and I don't know if you can see it in the shot. After the first pass, I could have stopped, but I think I was using the same settings from the previous job or something that I had opened, an old job that I had opened from a different machine, and it had two passes. I didn't need to do two passes. One would have been a plenty. From there, I did a stainless steel dog tag, and it's inside of a plastic carrier. This is like a fixture that I made. If you were doing a lot of these, I highly recommend using a fixture of some type. I just made this up and 3D printed it several years ago, and you can just set the tag in a very repeatable spot. And to keep the air assist from taking it, I just had a piece of painter's tape holding the tag there, and it turned out great. This is an interesting little octopus image, and I'll have a close-up of it. But there's very little heat distortion on the back. Using the air assist really keeps the heat out of the material. So the laser beam where it hits, that's where it's only doing the work. So you don't get a twisted tag. If you've seen any of my other review videos, and I do this test on pretty much every machine, sometimes the heat gets into it and it just curls up like a potato chip. But this time it stayed flat, so that's good. If anybody would like this file for this holder, let me know. I'll release the STL and put it in a place where everybody can download it if you're interested. From there, I moved on to this, and this is probably my favorite, if I'm being honest. And this is just a paisley print on this blue anodized tag. And this turned out fantastic. I tried it the first time. The air assist actually blew it off. I had it sitting on this piece of wood. The air assist skated it off, like air hockeyed it off, and it didn't do anything. So I just rolled a piece of painter's tape on the back and stuck it onto the board, ran it again. And I did it oversized on purpose because I wanted the images to drop off the edge of the part. And I just think it turned out so, so good. Was super happy with that. I did a cut test. So this is a piece of quarter inch or 6.35 millimeters, roughly, poplar. And I started at 10 millimeters a second. And once I got to 4 millimeters a second at 100% power, the piece just dropped off. And you'll see in the shot how the cuts step down as I'm decrementing 1 millimeter per second from 10. And so that turned out really, really well. From there, I moved on to the rotary. And this one was fun. The first rotary I used was the one that has the chuck on it. And I was grabbing the outside of this wooden segmented pin cup, and kind of, not to beat a dead horse, but I put the phonetic alphabet on that because I could see having this on my desk, and while you're sitting there talking to somebody on the phone and you're trying to talk alphanumeric, I could just glance over at this and kind of halfway sound like I know what I'm talking about. So I thought that was a good execution for that. It turned out beautifully. I can't say enough how much the manuals helped set both of these rotaries up, and so I could kind of hit the ground running. That was a huge help. So the second job that I did on the R2 rotary, which is the standard kind of flat roller type, is I had this idea, and I don't really know where this came from, but I saw these spools, or these thread spools in the craft store, and I'm like, so what? S-E-W-W-A-T. And I'm like, okay, that'd be kind of funny if somebody had that in their sewing room or their crafts room or something like that. And so when I executed it first, it came out backwards. And I'm like, okay, how'd I do that? I couldn't find anything in Lightburn just on the main screen, but when I went into the rotary setup, there's this nice little option called mirror. I turned on mirror, ran the job again, and I got what I wanted, where I can actually read it, and it's not backwards. And so I executed it one more time, and it came out perfect. So what? So that is what I was able to make with the Atomstack A12 Pro. All right, so let's talk pros and cons. On this, for the pros, the design for sure, the fact that it's the unibody construction, it's a very clean looking machine, especially with the nice cable management, which is also a huge plus in my book. That should add to the longevity of the machine, kind of keeping things out of harm's way. You're not running over the wires with the laser and possibly burning them. So that is awesome. Where they've got the ports and the switches and the ease of access to the connector for the rotaries, very easy. The ease of access to the switch, to switch between this motion and the rotary motion, is easy. It's just well thought out and well executed. The air assist, I could probably just do like a whole talk on this. It's so quiet. And it's very compact, and the fact that it ran as long as it did and barely got warm, part of me wants to crack this open and see how it's made. Maybe they can send me a dead one so I can look at it, but I find that very interesting, and it works great. The price would also be another pro. Again, we've looked at some really higher end machines recently, and this machine, for its wattage, has a lot of capability. And for the $450 price point for just the machine, that's kind of huge. And actually, that's, I think currently on the website, that's for the machine and this F30 air assist pump. So that gets you going right out of the box. So that is good, and that's a good price to entry if you're looking at getting into laser engravers. The ease of use of the machine in general, also combined with the ease of focusing. It doesn't get much easier than just dropping it down on the part, and whether you're going to do engraving or cutting, they've got the steps on the gauge so you can very easily set the focus. That's always a plus. The only way it could be any easier is if it did it for you. The speed of the machine, when it's homing, when it's going to do the preview, it's not like creeping, it's actually moving with a little bit of purpose, so I like that, especially when it's doing the job. Now, you could be limited on the speed based on the power or the material that you're trying to affect, that may be where a higher wattage laser could be better, so you can make more use of that speed. But this is a quick machine, to be sure. The smallness of the dot size, the way you can do the very fine cuts that we did on the stencil and the puzzle and all the other items that we cut, that very small dot size lends to really, really good detail. The universal USB, this one seems kind of silly and kind of simple, but it's kind of cool that I can plug this cable into the machine and then I've got both options on this side. I think that's a good add. I really like the fact that that's there, because I don't have a USB-C connector on my old laptop that I use for all these testing, so that worked great for me. The light burn compatibility, plus the fact that you can use Laser Gerbil or the AtomStack software. This has never come up, I don't think, on any review that I've done on the pro side, and that's documentation. Whether it's putting the machine together, which really wasn't that involved, more importantly, trying to set up and use both of the rotaries, the documentation was key for that, and it made the process so much more friendly and less stressful, because I have fought with those in the past on different types of machines, different brands of machines, and it can be kind of tricky to set those rotaries up. So I don't think that can be understated. That's a huge win. The fact that they do have the two different types of rotaries that give you a lot of flexibility for any cylindrical objects that you're trying to mark on. And then I kind of already mentioned it, but the cable management, it's just top notch. All right, so let's talk cons, and there's not a lot to talk about here. Some would say that the smaller work area could be a con, and it could be. I will say that I have never used the max dimension on any machine that I have ever tested for one job. Now, where that could be more of an issue is if you're trying to batch items and you're trying to use as much footprint as you can of the work area. And let's say that you're doing these slate coasters, and so you want to set up as many of them on here as you can. That could be where that maximum size, that's really where that limitation is going to show. But for most people, I don't think it's going to be an issue, but the work area is smaller. The clamps for the honeycomb bed, again, they're these little plastic kind of barbed pegs, basically, and they slide down in, and I was able to use it to kind of keep this item kind of positioned. I kind of bordered it to keep this in the right spot, and that worked fine. But I've used magnetic clamps before. I think it could be easier. I'm nitpicking a little bit. I could have even taped that down just onto here itself, but these, you know, they're adequate, but I think it could be better. The last thing was, and I noticed this when I took it out of the box, and so let me move this so I can kind of explain it. I'll need to turn it around this way. And this will be hard for you to see, but I hope I can explain it better. So the gap that's across the back of this, so there's a gap between this rail, this red rail, and the frame. When I looked at it after I took it out of the box, I could tell it was skewed. And so what I ended up doing was I basically just pushed the axis as far this way as it would go, and it squared it up. And I was able to kind of verify that by looking at the line between to see if this was parallel to this. And that's basically, I just eyeballed it. And I think that fixed everything, but it wasn't square when I took it out of the box. So I just kind of racked it to the back and hit the stops with it, and that squared it back up. Could have gotten hit in shipping that could have caused that, but that was just something that I noticed. That's more of a gripe, but to somebody that's new to laser engraving, you may not see that. So that might be something to consider, but that was it for the cons. All right, so that's a wrap on the AtomStack A12 Pro. I'd love to know what you think about it. Please leave those comments and questions down below. If you have any items you would like me to try in my next review, give me some ideas down below as well. It's hard to come up with new ideas sometimes, and I would enjoy some fresh ideas, so to speak. If you want any information about this machine or some of the test materials that I've used, those links will be down below as always. I thank you for spending your time with me, and I look forward to seeing you again.